Okay, so let's go on to the next one. The next topic was, what do you think about some of the famous atheists? And I'll let you start, Vinny, that you know, and I can bring up some names.
You get quite a list, and yeah. I actually don't watch them. I don't follow them. Richard Dawkins, I'm slightly familiar with his brand of atheism. He will never debate a presuppositionalist like myself.
Let's back up a bit. Okay, you're an apologist. An apologist means defending the faith. Now, some apologists, I think they kind of specialize. You know, like some might talk to Mormons, some might talk to Catholics. And so do you specialize in atheists, or do you try to do everything?
I wouldn't call it a specialization, but I tend to attract most people who profess atheism. On the streets, I talk with people of differing worldviews. I've not had formal debates yet with people of other worldviews. Whether I would do that, I think I would consider it. People think that I love debating. You know, I would be happy if I had never had another debate. I'd be happy if, Bernie, you came up to me and said, you know, man, I'm a believer now. You know, I would put my trust in Jesus Christ. But if you say, no, I want to debate you, you know, it's not something that I particularly like to do, but I'll do it.
So you don't specialize it with atheism then? Or
it's not a special. I specialize in Christianity. And the thing is, we're supposed to give an answer to anybody.
Yeah, what I mean by that, though, is like if you really want to relate to somebody, it helps to know their background. So like if you want to reach out to Muslims, you know, it really help a lot to know what the Quran teaches.
I wouldn't say it's atheism is my specialty. Atheists, or those who profess atheism, is the majority of the work that I've done publicly anyway.
Okay.
But I will talk with anybody who rejects Christ as their Lord because I want them to be saved.
Okay, so let's start with Richard Dawkins. He's by far the the richest and the most famous atheist. Can you say some good and bad things about him?
He's created in the image of God. That's a good thing. And he's rejected.
Well, that goes for everybody, right?
Right.
Okay, so how about him uniquely?
If somebody said to me, like I said in the analogy in the other video, somebody came up to me and said, your wife is a prostitute. Mm-hmm. And you say, well, can you tell me good things about that person? You know, I wouldn't have a long list. I'd say they need to repent and put their trust in Jesus Christ. Richard Dawkins, the only thing that I know good of him is that he's a representative of God, but he's failed to represent him. He's created in the image of God. That's what's good about him. But from then on, his life is devoted to poking his finger in the eyes of the God that created him. So I have really nothing apart from the fact that he's created in the image of God to say good about anybody who professes atheism.
Just one point about the claim that somebody says, you know, your life is a whore. In some cases, that may be true for certain guys. I mean, maybe they're
I understand that. And Matt Dillahunty, that came up in our debate. And of course, when you have a worldview where there is no ultimate authority in morality, then it might be fine to say your wife is a whore. But according to Christians, whoredom, prostitution, is a sin. So if you were to accuse somebody of that, then you would be, especially in the case that it wasn't true, mm-hmm. you'd be besmirching them. So the example that I gave is accusing something of something that, according to Christianity, is sinful when it's not in fact true. Just like calling God a liar when he's not a liar. Calling somebody's wife a prostitute when she's not a prostitute, and that, according to your worldview, is sinful.
Right, but sometimes people do get bad news, and they're shocked, and they have to investigate it, and they might find out that, wow, I never knew this person.
However, if I know for a fact that my wife is not a prostitute, of course, again, I said I'm not married, and you come up and you start with that kind of accusation, then I'm not going to defend the integrity of my wife, because I know she's not. I'm going to say, buddy, that's my wife you're talking about. You better be very careful with your next word.
Okay, you know, as far as the prominent atheist celebrities out there, are there any of them that you think is there any topic or anything you can say good about them? Like anything, like they have a good point on this or?
Well, I think, you know, especially if you watch my videos, I would say that atheism has no leg to stand on. Philosophically, logically, morally, scientifically, they have no leg to stand on. And any argument that they profess for their belief system actually borrows from the Christian worldview. So, you know, I don't know, some of them might be brilliant scientists. I don't doubt that. Stephen Hawking's a brilliant man. He's done brilliant work in the scientific field. I don't know, I think Dawkins, his history is in biology. Mm-hmm. He might have done some brilliant work there, but he can only do that because he relies on the God that created him. But the difference is he suppresses the truth about that God, whereas I profess the truth. And that's one thing I say, when an atheist becomes a believer, they do not go from unbelief to belief. They go from suppressing the truth to professing the truth.
Well, let me tell you as an example, see if this changes your mind a little bit. When I was an evangelical Christian, of course, I disagreed with Dawkins and Harris, but when I saw, for example, Sam Harris, you're familiar with Sam Harris? I was impressed with Sam Harris because I thought, wow, that guy is calm and he's smart and he sticks to logic. So I like it. Even though I disagree with him, I like his approach and the way he thinks. And Richard Dawkins, there were some things that, well, I started to come to accept evolution, so. But there's another thing where he gave this TED talk about our place in this world. There's like small, medium, and large world, and we understand the scales of time and distance in this medium world, and we don't understand the small and large, you know, like the light years and all that. So anyway, I thought that was another brilliant insight too. Christopher Hitchens, I thought, was just rude. I was like, what a rude atheist. I mean,
have you seen his film with Doug Wilson, Collision?
Yeah.
You should check that out sometime.
Yeah, I did see it.
And they became actually kind of, in a weird way, kind of friends. And one thing that Hitchens said about Wilson, he respected Wilson. And Wilson was a presuppositionalist. And anybody who's not seen it, I encourage them to go and look up Collision. Yeah. It's a great film.
So anyway, I mean, as a Christian, I had some positive things to say about some of the atheists.
Well, like I say, I don't know them well enough, but I'm saying that he might have been a brilliant biologist. Fantastic. There's people who do brilliant things, but I'm saying that they do that because they rely on the God that created them.
Okay.
So, you know, is it good that they do those things? According to my standard, where I have a standard of good and evil, I can say some of the things they do is good, but according to their worldview, they have no basis for calling anything good or evil. Have they done good things? For instance, this is what I tell people when I'm on the street. If I help an old lady across the street, that's a good thing. If an unbeliever helps an old lady across the street, and if they don't do it for the glory of God, it adds to their condemnation. So when people say, I'm good enough to go to heaven, I do good things, and I say, define good. And apart from the God that created them, there is no definition of good. It's arbitrary. So when you think you're doing a good thing as an atheist, you're actually adding to your condemnation, because it says in Scripture, anything not done for the glory of God is sin. Anything not done in faith is sin.
What do you think? I mean, here's kind of an extreme, funny example twist on that. What about Mother Teresa, who dedicated her entire life to helping the people? Then she, you know, it turns out that she says, "Well, I don't even know if God exists." I mean,
see, I would say, first of all, I know a lot of people who are going to watch this, if anybody does watch it, they would have some issues with Mother Teresa herself. Now, Mother Teresa was Roman Catholic, and I'm not a Roman Catholic. You know, I believe that that's a false religion. Are there Christians within Catholicism? You know, there probably are. However, her not professing belief in God, her being a Roman Catholic, it would be an indication that she's not a Christian. So all the good works, which are apparently good on the outside, if you were asked Mother Teresa, who says, well, I'm not sure that God exists, according to you, I'm not even sure she would say that. However, let's say she did say that. And I say, why are you doing this thing? She said, well, what goes around comes around.
No, she said because Jesus commanded it. He said, like, you know, when you do this to them, you know, to the least of these, you do it to me. So that's why she did it, because of an expectation that God wants this done for her, wants this done.
However, you just said that that at the end of her life, she said she doesn't even know that God exists.
Right, right.
So that cannot be her reason for doing it, then, because she's not even sure that, you know, that God exists.
She can do things with doubts, can't she? I mean,
Yeah, however, the question is, was she a Christian? Was she really doing it for that, or was she doing it for something that she envisioned in her mind? Because this is the question that I ask people, are you sure that God exists? And sadly, a lot of Christians say that they're not. And I say, what if I told you I have a wonderful, loving relationship with my wife? I'm just not sure she exists. You'd have every right to question my relationship, let alone my sanity. And what people don't understand is that people have doubts, but doubt is a sin.
Well, the
doubt for the existence of God is a sin, but it says also in Scripture, be merciful.
Well, the example with your wife, I don't think makes sense, because that's a person that's tangible. You can actually see, touch, and feel.
Well, I see that God is tangible with every one of your thoughts. With every thought in your head, with every word that you speak, God is tangible.
In a metaphorical sense, maybe.
No, not metaphorical. Because, for instance, okay, now you're
having... Tangible means you can touch it, taste it, you can
physically
relate to it somehow. That's the definition of tangible.
As a Christian, I say that I can. See, because the thing is, you are physically uttering sounds out of your mouth. Mm-hmm. And I'm saying that is evidence of God. Now, why is that the case? You are thinking thoughts in your head and you're about to utter sounds. You're about to utter sounds into the ether. And hang on 1 second. So the sounds that you're about to make, you're going to formulate them into words. And you are going to assume that those words mean the same thing they did 5 seconds ago. Mm-hmm. Because otherwise you wouldn't speak.
Sure.
So now the thing is, when you do that, my question as a Christian, on what basis do you assume that those sounds you're about to make mean the same thing they did 5 seconds ago? So it's a problem of induction. I say, on what basis do you assume that the future will be like the past?
No, what does it have to do with being tangible?
Well, because I'm saying that all of these physical things are evidence of God. Right? So I'm saying that everything, this wall, this chair, anything that we make sense of, these tangible things are evidence of God.
No, I mean, but it's not like your wife. Your wife is a person you can touch and see.
I can touch this table. I can make sense. I can listen to your sound.
Right,
now, the thing that's very interesting is that you stop me at that point. Because my question is, I'm saying that every word that you speak is evidence of God, tangible evidence of God. I say, I see him in everything.
I think we need to do that in the next section where we talk about reality and truth.
Fine.
So, yeah. I just thought the word tangible has a literal definition as something you can touch, literally, physically connect to somehow. And
right, but the thing is, that falls apart in your worldview too, because if you say, I have evidence of my wife,
mm-hmm.
and I say, evidence presupposes God. So I say, really, you don't even know your wife exists according to your worldview.
Okay, I guess we'll hold off on talking about that later. Let's see, what did we say that led up to that? I'm trying to remember. We were talking about, Mother Teresa. Let's say, for example, you don't know if this is the case or not, but let's say it is the case that she dedicated her whole life to helping the less fortunate, all because of the Bible passage primarily that said, Jesus says, when you do this to the least of these, you do it to me. And, a lot of Christians say, I want that verse to apply to me where God says, well done, good and faithful servant. So let's say she did it all in obedience to God, but yet she did have serious doubts whether God existed or not.
Well, thankfully, I'm not the judge of Mother Teresa.
Okay.
I don't know what was in her heart of hearts.
Well, I mean, according to your theology,
though. Well, the thing is, according to Roman Catholicism, I believe that salvation is by faith in Jesus Christ alone. You know what the Roman Catholic Church teaches?
I used to be a Catholic, so yeah, I know it very well.
What does it say? What does the Roman Catholic Church teach about salvation by faith in Jesus Christ alone? Do you know what it teaches? Council of Trent, Canon 9, it says that's anathema. So the Roman Catholic Church believes that I'm cursed for my foundational belief that salvation is by faith in Christ alone. Now, Mother Teresa, as a Catholic, she would also, if she's consistent with the Roman Catholic Church, believe that salvation by faith in Christ alone is anathema, is cursed. So do you know what they believe in? Faith by salvation by faith in Jesus Christ plus works. And that might be the case why she was in Calcutta helping these children, because she was in some way trying to earn merit with God.
Mm-hmm.
And if that's the case, that's anathema.
Yeah, the merit thing is I left Catholicism. I mean, if you look at the catechism and learn about purgatory and indulgences.
Right. Well, you can get time on purgatory if you follow the Pope on Twitter.
Sure. You can say a rosary, you can visit a gravesite.
Right.
There's a handbook of indulgences actually for sale still. I mean, a lot of Catholics don't even know indulgences are still practiced. But
now, here's the thing, though. Are there people within the Roman Catholic Church who believe salvation by faith in Christ alone? Absolutely. But once they find out what the church teaches, they need to get out. Now, Mother Teresa, was she doing this? Was she believing salvation by faith in Christ alone? I don't know. I don't know enough about her. But I'm not the judge of her. God is the judge of her, and he'll know. And God judges, and he judges rightly.
Okay, so on this segment, we were talking about what your view of some of the famous atheists are. I'll give you 30 seconds to wrap up. Do you want to have a closing comment on this?
That's fine. I would think that they're created in the image of God, and in that, they represent the God who created them, and they might do things that, according to their worldview, appear to be good. And I'm saying that anything not done in faith is sin. So if they do things that they think are good, if it's not done in faith, it's sin. And the goodness about them is that they're created in the image of God, and as long as they're breathing on this earth, they have the opportunity to repent and put their trust in Jesus Christ.
Okay, so let's go to this. The final section now we're in is called, we're talking about reality and truth.